Another video for you. Since I'm on break now, I'll be able to post a lot more. I do want to go hit up the drag strip and post a lot more fun stuff that I have planned, especially since it's summer now and I have nothing else to worry about. With today's video, I have a few things that I want to put in my car, because like I've said before, I had a thing that was coming up and it's time to... Alright, so today I have in store some new spark plugs. These spark plugs are cooler than the stock ones and then normal ones that Ford recommends. The reason why I'm putting cooler spark plugs to make sure detonation doesn't occur sooner than it should. These spark plugs are going to be gapped to 0.035. Here's my little gauge that I'm going to be putting in. Okay, so I got that quick and simple. Then I have a PMOS intake that I'm going to be putting in. My car currently has the CNL intake, the racer I believe, which is a 92 millimeter. And if I believe this is a 110 or something like that, there's a huge difference. And plus, since I have a bunch of ported stuff in my car, there should be a slight improvement, especially from what I read. When putting in just different spark plugs in the car, it definitely wakes it up, especially when it's cooler. Just from what I saw in the reviews, like on American Muscle. Let's just get started. I'm gonna gap these real quick, and then I'm gonna put the spark plugs in, and then do the simple install with the intake. Upload the two, and then let's see if there's a difference between the CNL and the PMOS intake. It is always good to check the gapping before you put in a set of spark plugs to get the right specifics. You just want to make sure it's factory spec. For NA cars, usually wanted a 0.049 to a 0.053 is what I believe the Ford spec is for NA. But for boosted and nitrous applications, you want a 0.028 to a 0.032, if I believe is correct. That little slit that you saw, you stick it in on the thin side and you slowly work your way up until it kind of gets rough, but not too bad because you will open it up. And then, like I said, I'm gonna be gapping these to a 0.035, which is like right here. But stock is usually somewhere up here. As I said, the numbers just previously, but let's get to it. Okay, so first, of course, you pop up the hood, you want to look underneath the engine bay. And this is my first time I ever show the engine bay of my personal car. But, of course, you're going to want to access the coils right here. So what you want to do is, you're going to want to remove this that's leading in, well, for me, to catch can on this side. You want to remove this little PVC pipe. You want to remove this hose right here. And you're going to want to remove the oil filler cap, whatever thingamabob. And then this is plain and simple. This just pops off nice and easy. Quick note for anyone that's actually curious. Yeah, I got a ported Boss. I'm on L coilovers. Got a throttle body spacer. And got a GT350 throttle body. Now that you have the coil cover off, you're going to want to put the oil cap back on. Because you don't want any like dust or debris to get into your engine, you know. Especially since the chains are showing right there. Okay, so all you want to do is lift up this red tab. As you can see, these ones are down. And I'm not like CJ Pony where I show you, well, I'll tell you that it is easy. You might break a nail or two, you know, for those little feminine ones out there. Probably just get a flathead and just pop it up. But once that is unlocked, all you do is press this down and then out comes the connector. And then you want to loosen up the 8mm and then pop out the coil. And let me do it all on four sides here because, you know, I kind of need two hands for this. As you can see, all the 8mm bolts are out on all four sides. All tabs are up. Then, like I said, all you do is lift up the tab, push the button. And then once you remove the 8mm, boom, out comes the coil. Personally, I would just leave them like cylinder per cylinder. So I'm gonna do one side at a time. And then you can mark them with some tape and like put a number on them. But I'm just gonna lay them softly on my manifold, just in order, just so I don't mix them up. I'm probably in the future should just get some new coils. Then if anyone that's, any of my Mustang lovers that are out there that have like aftermarket ones and don't have any issues, just let me know in the comments how the thing goes and how it runs. From what I've read, they tend to have issues, but you know, I'm always up for trying something new. But yeah, and let me just pop all these off. And then all you do is hit the spark plug next right there. In order to get the spark plug, you're gonna need a 5/8 socket. Then I have a little rubber inside here to catch it, but if you don't have that and have issues trying to get it,
just grab a magnet and then just touch that little end right there, and then it'll just come out nice and easy. All right, as you can see, I have one spark plug out. I'm actually gonna focus on one cylinder, show you how to do it, then I'm gonna finish the rest. But of course, right here, as you have one spark plug out,
what I'm gonna do is just keep them organized, because I would do want to check each individual spark plug on each cylinder and see how it was running.
Now, next, what you're gonna wanna do is replace it with a new spark plug. And then you're gonna wanna use this with it. You know, it's always best to lubricate it, just in case your spark plug gets stuck. You don't wanna risk ruining up the thread in the head and having it get stuck, you know. And then once you have this in, what you're gonna wanna do is torque it to the NGK spec, which for these, the minimum is 7 pounds, while the maximum is 14, or you can just do it by hand, you know, just guess it. But for me, I just don't wanna ruin the head, so I'm just doing it by that. Most of the cylinders is basically the same thing, except for that rear one, which I'll get to, when I get to it, I'll show you guys my little trick that I use to make that process go a lot smoother. Now it's time for the one that some people tend to have issues with. How I found it best to do is, of course, just drop, you want to drop that socket in there, the 5/8. Once you put the socket in, now you're going to want to use a swivel with a small extension. Then you're going to want to just work that sucker in, and you can feel the socket, and then it connects like that. As you can kind of see the socket kind of sticking out, now you're going to want to go and get another small extension. For those who are even wondering why I even put a swivel in, well, with a swivel, it allows you to lift it upward just enough where you can actually get a wrench in there and then loosen it up, and then there's still enough clearance to take it out. And then once you've taken it out, you can loosen it by hand like this. But then with the angle the swivel supplies, boom, easy. And just like that, all four cylinders are now done. I'm gonna move on to the rear side. As you can see, I had them all in order. Okay, so a little incident just happened. As you can see, all you do is push down these tabs. Look what happened. Freaking broke. All I did was just push it down, and then it snapped. Luckily, this is just like a locking pin. There's still a clip that clips into place. In order for this to come out, it has to be pushed in and then pulled up, and then I'm just gonna like wing it. And then if this somehow comes out, I'll put like a little, like, then I'll put like a paper clip, but you know, as some of my friends like to say, Mickey Mouse Garage over here. But it should hold. If anything, I'm just probably gonna go get a paper clip right now and just put it in there, or figure out something to get it to hold. But yeah, a little side note.
Okay, so after doing all 8 cylinders, one thing I noticed, as you can see the tip of this thing, how it's not fully straight and it's just out of focus, but yeah, it is not fully straight and lined up with the needle. And this was on the passenger side, front, facing the radiator. This one's off-centered, and I have 2 on this side, on the driver's side, that were also off-centered. I don't know how much that would have affected, like, horsepower gains. I think it was all of them. As you guys can see, everything's all buttoned up and looking good. Except, I mean, by looking good, I mean dirty. Okay, so as you guys can see, I have the CNL intake, which is 95 millimeters, which the PMOS is extremely bigger. I mean, overall, like, see how, like, thin this is? And, well, I'm going to go ahead and take this off. As you can see, I have a few things deleted, such as the sound tube and stuff. But for this, it's simple, because all I have to move is this jerry-rigged oil catch can that I made for my driver's side, which was originally on the passenger side, but since it got sponsored, I have this now. And of course, I didn't want this to go to waste, so I just slapped it on. Of course, I check this periodically, and this doesn't collect that much oil, but it does. But you know, something's better than nothing, you know. But for me, of course, just remove this one little hose, remove this clamp right here, remove this right here, move, and then take out my MAP sensor, and then out comes the tube. Alright, so real quick and easy, I have the intake out. Let me just quickly go over like what I've done to my car. As you guys can see, some rigging going up in here. So my car is an FBO. I do have a set of long tubes. You can barely see them, but they're down there. You can kind of see the bluish up in there. My car is an FBO Mustang. I have a GT350 throttle body,
as you can see, I ported. And for those who are gonna say, oh, you could have cleaned this up better, I was already very close. And then as you can see right here, this ridge line, it's very thin. So I didn't wanna risk eating too much. So I left it how it sits. But for me, a lot of people tend to have issues with the GT350 throttle body because there's a huge, like, for those who've seen it, there's like this ridge that comes up and sticks out. That's awful. And a lot of people tend to have issues with tuning it and drivability. And for me, I just personally believe it kind of messes up with the whole airflow of things because it's like a wall. The air has to hit it and then change directions, which kind of throws stuff off, especially when you want daily use of it. So I opened this up quite a bit, this whole thing, and it's more of as straight of a shot as I can get. But okay, so I have the GT350 throttle body with, of course, a ported Boss 302, and normally the setup doesn't really work because here goes a coolant line right here. It hits, as you can see. So with the adapter, of course, I needed a throttle body spacer, and some of you guys who saw this in the beginning were probably like, oh, why does he have a throttle body spacer? Well, I kind of had to in order to create this clearance. See how tight this is? Without the throttle body spacer, I wouldn't be able to do this. And if I was to flip the throttle body, well, technically the throttle body is flipped right now. Normally it would be the other way, which for those who, if you can see this down part of the throttle body right there, how big that is. Do you know how high this Boss 302 manifold is? If it's flipped normally, it hits the hood, and even if we were to cut the hood, that thing, like, it's stuck up like quite a bit. And already, as you can see, in order to fit the Boss, I put that little cut right there. I painted it black, and if I didn't point that out to you, most people don't see it, especially like when I go open it up to like a car meet or something, and I show people. So now you can kind of see why I had to use a throttle body spacer. On top of that, I have the LU 47 pound injectors inside, of course, tuned. Oh, right there. Okay. Now you can see my headers just chilling up in there. And my headers are a whole nother topic that I kind of want to get into. But for the throttle body, as you can see, I had to extend the wiring going from here to here, which wasn't that bad. This is all soldered. It's not just spun together. It's all soldered in. Well, other than that, she's pretty chilling. The runner is reported, of course, when it goes along with the whole porting process. Overall, let's go see the difference between this intake and then the other intake I'm gonna be putting it in. Okay, so first impressions, CNL, PMAS. Intake completely different. See the size of it? First, I mean, it's tapered, and then it has an opening for more airflow, while the CNL does not. But let's see the entrance of it. Huge difference just by looking at it. Obviously, you can see the difference between the inlet. Now, let me go show you guys the tubes. Okay, so here goes the difference. Here goes the CNL. Here goes the PMAS. The holes, I mean, like, I'm not going to take anything out and measure it, but as you can see, this is slightly bigger. As you can see, the PMAS utilizes all this area to allow for more air to go in, while the CNL doesn't, as you guys can kind of see the hard angle. But yeah, let me just go and try installing it, and let's see if it works with my whole setup. But most likely I'm going to have to rig something up, but that's the name of the game when modifying, right? Alright guys, so some time has passed, and majority of this is now on. I did have to make my own bracket, because due to the angle of the Boss manifold, it was touching a little too much over here. So I went ahead and I just made my own like little bracket and kicked it out even further. So the more clearance, you know, just I wanted it. It wasn't necessary, but something I wanted to do. This is now on. What I am gonna be doing is incorporating two different intake designs into one. I am just gonna be taking the one from the CNL, the cover, and putting it over like this to keep water from falling into the vent. The reason why I'm not gonna be using the heat shield that comes in it is because there's only one little source of airflow to be going into this thing, and I just think that it's not gonna use this intake to its full capacity. And plus, those who've like been in my car, due to my grill, my intake air temps are completely low. This thing, my bumper allows in so much air, and my temps are always down. So I'm gonna try this, and then if my intake temps are high as heck, then I'm gonna put the heat shield with a one little entrance in.
Alright guys, so I'm basically done as far as my car. The new spark plugs are in, the intake is in, the modifications I had to do are done. Now all I gotta do is upload the new tune, turn it on, and I'm probably gonna cut to tomorrow with the cold start and me driving the car around and watching to see if there's a huge difference between the PMOS and the CNL intake, which, I mean, from what I've seen, the openings are much bigger, so let's see the improvements that it comes with it.
Alright guys, so now here goes the test drive to see if I notice any slight differences between the intakes and the spark plugs. So far, I've been driving the car for about 10 minutes, and I can say, even though I am on a baseline tune, the throttle stiffened up even more, especially due to my mods, and now that I have increased the amount of airflow going into my intake, you know, slight gains. Improving the airflow on an NA car definitely shows. Like, I know with boosted cars, if you have 10 more horsepower than someone, it doesn't really matter, but in an NA car, that 10 horsepower does matter. So definitely having the most efficient intake definitely does improve performance. As far as spark plugs, you can't really tell. I mean, like, from what I've read, having the heat range cooler definitely does make an improvement. So that on top of the intake, you know, it could just be because of those two mods that are now in my car, or, you know, the stereotype that everyone always says that it's just the driver and it's all in our head, which, I mean, it could be, who knows, you know, but you won't really officially know until I put it to the test, which will be after my car is fully, once I get all the revisions and the tune is fully where I want it to be. But dang, that rear end is so loose compared to Adrian's car. For those who know me, I have yet to lose to another NA car that's like truly NA, not someone who's spraying on the low, but that, you know, it doesn't really count, you know. That deal with the supercharger guys, but they don't want it. But if anyone's wondering about the exhaust I have, yeah. Long tube headers, no cats, JBA. JBA catback alone, it's really mild. You can't really tell that you have an exhaust. Well, you can tell just because how deep it is, but just because how deep it is the reason why it's so quiet. But once you have long tubes, it sounds like a pure American car. It's not raspy, it's not insane, it's toned very deep, and it sounds good. You know, it's all preference, you know. There are people out there that like, there's people out there who just like their S550 straight pipes, which, I mean, like, honestly, I used to be one of those guys way back then. But since then, I manned up and got an exhaust. With that said, I'm gonna be wrapping it up now. Hope you guys found my video a little intriguing. Let me know if you guys want to know any more about my car. If you guys want to see me gap some arrows, take out some Hellcats. No, I'm kidding. But let me know what you guys want to see. Again, I'm on summer break now, and I'm totally free for the most part. If you guys like the video, you know, give it that thumbs up. If not, tell your friends. You know, tell them how much you hate me and let them watch the video. Hopefully they give me the thumbs up. But yeah guys, stay tuned for my upcoming videos, and yeah.